California and the Easter Rising. California, like much of America, has had the strongest of links with Ireland. From the initial days of the gold rush, when many Irish migrants came in search of gold, many escaping the nightmare of an Ireland ravaged by the Great Famine.
Oh, Paddy dear, and did you hear the news that's going around? The shamrock is by law forbid to grow on Irish ground.
Many brought their dreams of freedom and connection to home with them.
His colour can be seen, for there's a cruel law against the wearing of the green.
In 1876, a daring raid to rescue seven imprisoned Fenians from an Australian prison involved a San Franciscan, Thomas Desmond. He was part of the Catalpa rescue, organized by New York-based John Devoy, along with John Breslin. They were part of a growing Clan na Gael organization. Breslin commended Desmond for his part in the rescue. On Desmond's return to San Francisco, he was lauded as a hero and was elected sheriff from 1880 to 1881 through the support of the Working Men's Party. Later, he would serve as an officer of the Knights of the Red Branch, one of the city's strongest Irish nationalist groups. In September 1880, Michael Davitt, founder of the Land League in Ireland, would visit Sacramento, Oakland, and San Francisco. Thousands in Oakland held a torchlight procession to greet him. In San Francisco, he would speak to a large crowd, where he talked of the importance of the movement towards land ownership in Ireland for all, and his commitment to non-violent action to bring about that reform. The largest Irish organisation of the time were the Ancient Order of Hibernians, who were keen to remember battles of the past, as this St. Patrick's Day article from the San Francisco Call shows. The California branches would hold regular conventions in the city. The AOH would collect thousands of dollars in donation for Irish relief funds, funds that would fuel the push for independence. In the early 1880s, a Galway-born priest, Father Peter York, would come to San Francisco. He was appointed editor of the Catholic newspaper, The Monitor, and later The Leader. York was the leading voice for workers' rights, and more importantly, the leading voice for Irish independence across the West Coast. He would often use his pulpit to preach independence for Ireland and an end to British rule there also. Douglas Hyde, later to become Ireland's first president, visited the city as leader of the Gaelic League in early 1906. In his address to those present at the St. Francis Hotel, he said, "Nationality does not consist in cheap rentals or in pounds, shillings or pence. Nationality consists in the preservation of national customs, language, feelings, and the raising of self-respect of the people." The event was organised by former Irish-American Mayor James Duval Phelan. Phelan was one of the wealthiest men in California and was always keen to promote the Irish in the city of San Francisco, and would eventually in 1914 become a senator for California in the U.S. Senate. In his earliest days, he fought to maintain U.S. neutrality in World War I, particularly with regards to supplying arms to the British. Throughout this time, the Irish community of San Jose were active in supporting the Irish cause for freedom, most notably in the story of one Michael Edward Griffith. He was the son of a successful gold miner and became an active member of the local branch of the AOH in San Jose shortly after graduating from Santa Clara College. In 1910, he attended the AOH Californian Convention in San Jose, along with thousands of AOH and Knights of Columbus members, and was elected as the organization's state treasurer. In 1912, he was elected secretary for the following 6 years.
As down the glen one Easter morn to a city fair rode I, there armed lines of marching men in squadrons passed me by. Life did hum, nor battle drum did sound its dread tattoo, but the angelus bells o'er the lippy swell rang out in the foggy dew.
Irish men and Irish women, in the name of God and of the dead generations from which she receives her old tradition of nationhood. Ireland, through us, summons her children to her flag and strikes for her freedom. Having organized and trained her manhood through her secret revolutionary organization, the Irish Republican Brotherhood, and through her open military organizations, the Irish Volunteers and the Irish Citizens Army, having patiently perfected her discipline, having resolutely waited for the right moment to reveal itself, she now seizes that moment, and supported by her exiled children in America and by gallant allies in Europe, but relying in the first on her own strength, she strikes in full confidence of victory.
But the bravest fell, and the requiem bell rang mournfully and clear. For those who died that Eastertide in the springing of the year. And the world did gaze freedom's light might shine through the foggy dew.
Reaction in Irish America was almost overwhelming. Few had guessed that the rising was coming, so secretive it had all been in the planning. John Devoy, who had been masterminding funding and resources in America, was able to call on old friends and allies like Father York and Senator Phelan to rally to Ireland's call. Phelan would immediately raise the abominable treatment and martyrdom of the leaders, calling for Irish freedom from British rule. Michael Griffith, along with other AOH leaders such as Jim Byrne from Los Angeles, would immediately join and support the Friends of Irish Freedom, putting their weight behind the surviving leaders of the Rising, most directly Eamon de Valera. Monetary support increased dramatically, with many thousands of dollars flowing towards the fight for independence. Rallies were held up and down the state to raise funds and awareness. Hannah Sheehy Skeffington, wife of Francis Sheehy Skeffington, who had been shot by firing squad just 2 days into the Rising, came to speak at various locations in California, both in Los Angeles and in Berkeley. By 1919, the whole of the Irish American community were fully supportive of the continuing push for Irish freedom. In Ireland, De Valera had become president of Dáil Éireann and believed he had to secure strong support from America. He set off in June of 1919, receiving rapturous support wherever he travelled. He was mobbed in places like New York, Butte, Montana, and most readily by enormous crowds in San Francisco. It was here that he presented Senator Phelan and the people of California with a statue of Irish patriot Robert Emmet, which stands today in Golden Gate Park. The Easter Rising was the pivotal moment in the birth of the new Irish nation. Its effects reverberated around the world. In a year, it encouraged a similar rising in Russia. History shows that the Californian Irish played their part in supporting, encouraging and funding the revolution that would change the course of Irish history forever.
Then I will change the colour too I wear in my cabin, but till that day